Shri Karthikeya IAS Academy. So these are the set of articles under daily current affairs dated on 15th August 2019, and today topics are: first topic, it is non-banking finance corporations and housing finance corporation. It would come under GS3 of economy, economic topic. It is next stubble burning. It is the agriculture topic under GS1 geography. And next, the priority sector lending by banks to NBFCs for on-lending. From this, I mean the NBFCs is also going to come under the priority sector lending, and they too lend the loans to the agriculture, medium scale industry enterprises and housing, and those loans will come under the priority sector lending, and this covers the part of economy. Next, it is Swachh Bharat Urban. So there are four dimensions newly launched by the Government of India under this Swachh Bharat initiative. It will come under social issues of GS1. And next, it is regarding the miscellaneous topic, that is geofiber. So where the Reliance Industries have launched a new initiative with the geofiber, providing telephone net facility and set-up box facilities under this initiative. So this initiative will be explained to you extensively in this article. And next, it is Haryana Administrative Tribunal. So it comes under the polity concepts, that is administrative tribunals. So I'll be explaining you this concept detailedly. Next, it is Palani Panchamritam. It comes under history and culture and social issues too of GS1. So I'll be explaining you the details and facts regarding Palani Panchamritam. Next, NJIT Srinivas Committee. This committee has been appointed to suggest the recommendations regarding CSR, that is corporate social responsibility. So it comes under the social issues and the economy also. So these are the wide variety of topics which we are going to discuss today. Now, the first article regarding NBFCs and HFCs. So the Government of India has issued a scheme to provide a one-time partial credit guarantee to public sector banks for purchasing pooled assets of financially sound NBFCs. See, those NBFCs which are financially sound, they too have some pooled assets. Pooled assets ante, these are the assets which are grouped together to minimize the risk, because maybe those assets can reproduce the non-performing, they can become non-performing assets. There is a possibility. So in order to minimize the risk, the concept of pooled assets has been introduced, and the NBFCs which has the pooled assets and the public sector banks which are going to purchase those pooled assets of the NBFCs will get the one-time partial credit announced by the Government of India. So under the scheme called this partial credit guarantee offered by Government of India to public sector banks for purchasing high rated pooled assets from financially sound non-banking financial companies or housing finance companies. So this is the scheme. Under this scheme, this one-time partial credit will be guaranteed by the Government of India to public sector banks who purchased the pooled assets of financially sound NBFCs. Coming to the objectives, we have two objectives under this. First objective is to address temporary assets liability of NBFCs or HFCs, Housing Finance Corporation companies, that is HFCs. And the other objective includes to prevent distressed sale of their assets in order to meet their commitments. These are the two objectives of this scheme which were introduced by the Government of India. Coming to the validity of this scheme, the partial credit offered by Government of India has a window period of 6 months from the date of issuance of scheme or till such date by which 1 lakh crore rupees of assets got purchased by the banks, whichever is earlier. This is the window of the scheme. Coming to the eligibility criteria, those NBFCs which are registered with the Reserve Bank of India are qualified to get this partial credit from Government of India, whereby this scheme excludes the microfinance institutions and core investment companies. Those are excluded. And this HFC, that is housing finance companies, which are registered with the National Housing Bank under the National Housing Bank Act, are eligible for getting this one-time partial credit. And the microfinance institution and core investment companies are not covered under this scheme, as I have told you earlier. So what is the significance of this scheme? The most importantly, this scheme would provide liquidity to NBFC sector, which are under stress following the series of defaults by group companies which belong to the infrastructure sector and financial service sector. So this would provide the liquidity to the distressed NBFC sector. And next importantly, there is another significance. It enables NBFCs to continue to play their important role in meeting the finance requirements of the productive sectors of economy, that is MSMEs, retail, housing. So these two are important, the significance of this scheme. So this is about the scheme. And next article regarding the stubble burning. So according to the Director General, that is of Indian Council of Agriculture Research, India has achieved considerable reduction in crop residue burning incidents in 2018. Going into the details, the Government of India has launched promotion of agriculture mechanization for in-situ management of crop residue in the states of Punjab, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh and National Capital Territory of Delhi. What is this scheme? This is a central sector scheme launched for the period of 2018-19 to 2019-20. So what is the objective of this scheme? It has two objectives. First objective is to tackle air pollution. Second objective is to subsidize machinery which is required for in-situ management of crop residue in the states of Punjab, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh and National Capital Territory of Delhi. So what is the strategy? The strategy is through the establishment of custom hiring centers, where it will, this CHCs, that is custom hiring centers, will undertake information, education and communication activities for creating awareness among farmers regarding the in-situ crop residue management machinery. So this is the strategy. And coming to the implementing mechanism, ICAR, that is Indian Council of Agriculture Research, is implementing the scheme through 60 Krishi Vigyan Kendras distributed over Punjab, Haryana, Delhi and Uttar Pradesh. So coming to the achievements under this scheme, there is a considerable reduction in the paddy residue burning events under this scheme, and more than 4,500 villages in Punjab and Haryana were declared as zero stubble burning villages. So this stubble burning practice of agriculture is a part of zoom cultivation or shifting cultivation. Please do refer that. So coming to the next important article, that is economic, that article belongs to the economy module, priority sector lending, that is PSL, lending by banks to NBFCs for on lending. So coming to the news, the lending of loans by registered NBFCs, those NBFCs like other than microfinancial institutions, towards agriculture, micro and small enterprises and housing sector up to prescribed limits will be treated as priority sector loans. This is as per the circular issued by Reserve Bank of India. So now the NBFCs, which is also coming under the ambit of lending the priority sector loans, mainly to agriculture, micro and small enterprises, housing purposes. So importantly, this will boost credit to the needy segment of borrowers. So on lending by NBFCs, that is, we have a term called term lending. On lending by NBFCs is called term lending. So we have certain limitations under different sectors. That is, for agriculture, it will be allowed up to 10 lakh per borrower. And coming to the micro and small enterprises, it is allowed up to 20 lakhs per borrower. And coming to the housing, this limit has been increased from the existing 10 lakh rupees to 20 lakh rupees per borrower. So under the revised on-lending model, banks can classify only the fresh loans sanctioned by NBFCs out of bank borrowing. However, loans given by housing finance companies under the existing on-lending guidelines will continue to be classified under priority sector by banks. So the next important article is regarding the Swachh Bharat. That is urban module of Swachh Bharat. We have two modules of Swachh Bharat, Gramin and Urban. So coming to the current dynamics in the news, the Union Minister for Housing and Urban Affairs launched four important schemes. One is Swachh Sarvekshan 2020 and Swachh Bharat Mission Water Plus Protocol and Toolkit and Swachh Nagar, that is an integrated waste management app, and it also enabled the artificial enabled MSBM app. So all these things will be explained detailedly in the following article. First, coming to the first one, Swachh Sarvekshan 2020. So it will be conducted in January 2020 by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, and it will be the fifth edition of the annual cleanliness survey. So we have been conducting this Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs is conducting the cleanliness survey, that too an annual part, and in subdivision this Swachh Sarvekshan 2020 is the fifth edition of this annual cleanliness survey. Coming to the next one, SBM, Swachh Bharat Mission Water Plus Protocol. So this aim is to provide a guideline for cities and towns to ensure that no untreated wastewater is released into the environment, because this untreated wastewater would amount to the release of methane, that is CH4, which is a greenhouse gas, into the environment. And also it aims to enable the sustainability of the sanitation value chain. We have the sanitation value chain, okay, to make a city or to make a town that is open defecation free. And this sustainability of the sanitation value chain led to the promotion of open defecation free plus and open defecation free plus plus initiatives. So this is the importance of SBM Water Plus Protocol. So it has two aims. One is to provide a guideline for the cities and towns to ensure that no untreated wastewater is released into the environment, and also it enables the sustainability of the sanitation value chain. Coming to the next one, next module, the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs has also launched the mobile app, that is called Swachh Nagar mobile app. So basically it is an integrated waste management app, and it will tackle several issues like lack of monitoring, collection of segregated waste, tracking the movement of waste vehicles and waste pickers. Okay, and these several issues are acting as obstacle for the effective waste management. So these several issues will be taken under the platform to resolve. That platform is Swachh Nagar mobile app. So next, artificial intelligence enabled the MSBM app. So basically, this app has been developed by the National Informatics Center. This National Informatics Center is the nodal agency for carrying out the e-governance initiatives, which was established in 1977. And this app will facilitate the applicants of individual household toilets under SBMU, Swachh Bharat Mission Urban, to know the status of their application in real time after uploading the photograph. So these are the set of initiatives launched by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, which is the nodal agency for implementing the Swachh Bharat Mission Urban. Coming to the next important article regarding geofiber, it comes under the miscellaneous topic. And coming to the news, Reliance Industries has unveiled its wired broadband service, that is Jio Gigafiber. So basically the new wired broadband service provided by the Reliance Industries is Jio Gigafiber. So this service is going to be started commercially from 5th September at rates which are 1/10 compared to global rates. So at very cheap rate, at very economical rate. So coming to the cost price of this initiative, that is called Jio Gigafiber, is starting at 700 rupees a month and going up to 10,000 rupees a month, depends upon the usage plans. And what are the components provided under this Jio Fiber? That is wide broadband connection, television content, that is set-top box, landline calling, and a host of smart solutions such as multiplayer gaming and video conferencing also. So under this Jio Gigafiber welcome offer, customers opting for 1-year plan for Jio Gigafiber will even get an HD 4K LED television and a 4K setup box free. So these are the provisions announced by the Reliance industry under this Jio Gigafiber. And this target is to reach 20 million homes, I mean to increase its market share, and 15 million business enterprises in 1600 cities across India. So target is clearly to increase the market share of Reliance in wired broadband services under this initiative called Jio Gigafiber. Coming to the next important article, that is Haryana Administrative Tribunal. So like the Punjab and Haryana High Court Bar Association has suspended work indefinitely since a notification came out on July 24 for setting up the Haryana Administrative Tribunal. Now it is the Haryana Administrative Tribunal will take up, after its coming into force, will take up the cases where the lawyers in this High Court Bar Association of Punjab and Haryana will start their pleading of cases. Details: the tribunal is meant to adjudicate over the service matters of the state employees that earlier will be directly heard by the High Court. Before the arbitration, I mean the cases related to the service matters of the state employees used to be heard by the High Court, but it is now the state administrative tribunals constituted under Article 323A of the Constitution is responsible to take over the adjudication over the service matters of the state employees. And what about the Haryana Administrative Tribunal? It is a quasi-judicial body on the lines of CAT, that is Central Administrative Tribunal, and its objective is to address the grievances of state employees concerning their employment. And the orders of these tribunals given by these tribunals can be challenged before the High Court. So under which law are the tribunals set up? As I have already told you in the earlier, Article 323A, which came by a way of 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act in 1976, enabled the centre to enact the Administrative Tribunals Act 1985 for setting up the tribunals for adjudication over disputes and complaints with respect to recruitment and conditions of service of persons. So basically the fact sheet is, it is provided, the establishment of tribunals will be provided under the Article 323A, which is added later during under the 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act in 1976. So this Article 323A has enabled the central government to enact, that is enable the parliament to enact this Administrative Tribunals Act 1985. And this Administrative Tribunals Act 1985 looks after the setting up of tribunals for adjudication over disputes and complaints with respect to recruitment and conditions of service of persons, the basically government employees. So the center under this act, that is this Administrative Tribunals Act 1985, can establish the tribunal for its own employees and also has the power to establish one for a state after receiving a request from the state government. So basically this Haryana Administrative Tribunal is established by the central government to hear the pleas from this Haryana state government employees. So two or more states can also agree for a single tribunal, where now in this case we have a single tribunal for Punjab and Haryana. Coming to the composition, the tribunal is to be headed by a chairman or chairperson, a retired High Court judge, and a number of judicial and administrative members. So the chairperson can be removed only by the President of India, and these tribunals can also have benches at different locations. So we have the regional benches concept in the tribunals. Why do we need this? Because the employees have no other option but to directly approach the High Court if the case of absence of tribunals. So the government decision to establish the tribunal has been pending since 2015, which aims at reducing a large number of pending cases before the High Court and quick disposal of the grievances of employees as per the state. So the need is, in order to resort to the quick disposal of the grievances of employees, we need the tribunals. Why is Bar Association opposing this move? They have three arguments. First is, the decision encroaches upon the jurisdiction of the court and is also aimed at circumventing the judicial independence. Because these tribunals are appointed by the parliament, which is out of the judiciary, where the legislature is encroaching into the powers of judiciary, that is encroaching the judicial independence of judiciary. Okay. They argue that tribunal members do not enjoy powers like judges who hold constitutional posts. The judges of the High Court will have the constitutional backup, where the judges of the tribunal will not have such. They are statutory in nature. The tribunals are also seen as a means to encroach upon the jurisdiction and judicial independence of High Court too. So these are the various arguments kept forward by the Bar Association in representing their opposition to this move. Next, it is about Palani Panchamritam. The famous Palani Panchamritam, given as Prasadam at the Murugan Temple at Palani, has been granted the geographical indication tag, JTAG. So basically the Palani is in Tamil Nadu. So in Palani we have a Murugan Temple there. This Palani Panchamritam will be served as Prasadam, and this Palani Panchamritam has gained the geographical indication tag. So this is the first time a temple prasadam from Tamil Nadu has been given the GI tag. We are in our state, that is in Andhra Pradesh, we have got a temple prasadam, that is Tirupati Laddu has got the GI tag from Andhra Pradesh. The Panchamritam is a combination of five natural substances: banana, jaggery, cow ghee, honey and cardamom. Dates and diamond sugar candies are added in this for flavor. Next, it's about Injective Srinivas Committee. So it is a high level committee on corporate social responsibility under the chairmanship of Sri Injati Srinivas. He was the secretary to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. So it has given the task to review the existing framework and guide and formulate the roadmap for a policy which is coherent and comprehensive on corporate social responsibility. Let us see what is this corporate social responsibility before this. So, corporate social responsibility is a part of social audit in the governance concept, whereby the private companies, private entities would come to serve as a part of government services to the in the concept of delivering the public services to the people. Basically, for example, if we take this movie theaters, so the movie theaters are private entities. They are providing the advertisement on the screen, which relate to the government schemes, which create awareness among the people regarding the social issues and diseases. Okay, it is a perfect example, classic example of corporate social responsibility. So it suggested that, this Injustice Inverse Committee suggested that violation should be regarded as civil offences that are liable to monetary penalties, along with a number of other suggestions to make CSR provisions more effective and less burdensome for companies. So the objective of this committee is to make CSR provisions more effective and less burdensome for companies, adding them some penal provisions to this CSR initiative, making the violation of CSR initiative as a civil offense. It also suggested CSR spending should be eligible for tax deductions. Whatever the companies who are investing their money in CSR activities, corporate social responsible activities, that money should be eligible for tax deduction. They should be given the tax concessions out of the habit of imposition of taxes over that spending. And the company should be allowed to carry forward the unspent balances which are aimed to spend under CSR, corporate social responsibility, for 3 to 5 years. So the panel wants banks and limited liability partnerships to be covered by a mandatory corporate social responsibility expenditure framework. So the panel suggested the banks and limited liability partnerships as a mandatory stakeholders for the CSR expenditure framework. And it emphasized that this CSR should not be regarded as a means of resource gap funding for government schemes. So the right now main limitation for the implementation concept of government scheme is there is a huge resource gap funding. So this CSR is aimed to fulfill that. And this this committee emphasized that CSR should not be regarded as a means of resource gap funding for government schemes, because I mean this is a perception we do have regarding CSR, that it would act as resource gap funding in the concept of government scheme. But it is the government should complete this fulfill this resource gap funding. It is only the contribution, which is very minute when compared to the government allocation. In such a way, the CSR should be treated. That perspective will make the burden of for the companies less. So the spending of CSR, CSR spending should be made a broad driven process to provide innovative technology based solution for social problems. This is the important line. So advantage of CSR, you can write, it will provide innovative technology based solution for social problems. And this committee is also emphasizing that the CSR spending should be made in such a way so that they can provide innovative technology based solutions for social problems. And it also recommended aligning CSR activities with sustainable development goals. We have 17 sustainable development goals, and in that it prescribed the inclusion of sports promotion, senior citizens welfare, welfare of differently abled persons, disaster management, heritage protection under permitted CSR activities. These are the set of activities recommended by this NJT Srinivas committee. And the panel finally recommended the development of CSR exchange portal to connect contributors, beneficiaries and agencies. This is important. To make the CSR initiative to be inclusive, the link between the stakeholders, different stakeholders, that is contributors of CSR, beneficiaries from CSR and agencies which implement the CSR, should be connected. So in order to connect it, the panel has recommended the development of a CSR exchange portal. And it also suggested social benefit bonds and promoting social impact companies besides third party assessment of major CSR project. So these are the set of articles under this today newspaper analysis. Hope this video will contribute to your preparation. Thank you very much.